I want to say a very big thank you for making time out of your very busy schedules to attend this event. It shows that you're very, very dedicated to a successful career. I am Danny Sarubi, the president and founder of the Finance Society. We thought that as a specialist business school, it had been great for us to set up a society. I would like to say a very big thank you to the committee members, to the university management, the careers team, and everyone else who has made sure that today is a reality. At this moment, I'll pass you on to our co-founder and treasurer, Moses Iwanji. Thank you.
Hello everyone, my name is Moses, co-founder and treasurer of the GSM London Finance Society. The reason for this Skills and Employability Seminar is that as a society we found it pertinent for students to understand the specific skills and attributes we need to get to our chosen careers. This is why we invited seasoned professionals from different fields encompassing finance and academia in order to give us valuable insights into what is required. These days, degrees graduates are very commonplace, and with the advancement of globalization, we are no longer competing with people in our respective country. We are now competing with them globally. Therefore, we need to distinguish ourselves from the rest of the competition. And this is one of the key reasons why we are holding this seminar today. I'll now be handing over to Mohammed, another committee member, who will be introducing the guest speakers for today. Thank you.
Okay, firstly, could I please invite Mr. Andrew Falconer. He's going to give us an introductory speech to the seminar today, please. Thank you.
Okay, good afternoon. My name is Andrew Falconer, and I'm Director of Careers and Employability with GSM London. I'd like to again thank you all for coming, and particularly for our speakers who have given quite a lot of time this afternoon to help you understand what did they do and where you might fit into that within your own career paths. But also, we wouldn't be here if it weren't for the GSM London Finance Society. I've only been in post for 4 weeks. I'm new. You guys know this place better than I do. It's a bit scary, isn't it? And on my second day, I met GSM London Finance Society. And they blew me away. Because these guys have put in so much effort into organising this event. The attention to detail has been absolutely superb. So why are you here? Well, 40 years ago, when the Greenwich School of Management was founded, since 40 years ago, about 20,000 students have graduated. 20,000. And you're part of that. You're part of that history, that legacy, that's going forward. And nowadays, it's even more important to have a degree in professional qualification of some sort. Last year, for the first time, the number of entry-level jobs that don't require a degree was less than those that do, for the first time ever. So having a degree has become increasingly important. So you guys are definitely in the right place. Have a look at this picture. I grew up in the 80s and 90s. In the 80s and 90s, shoulder pads, Dallas on TV, the original Dallas. That was what the impression I got of what a networking event might be like. It's a little bit scary. Has anybody ever seen a really good networker? Sometimes you'll see somebody in the room who just knows, seems to know instinctively how to do this. But actually, networking is something which we can all learn, and actually we all need to learn. Which of these do you think equates to the number of graduates who've got their first job through somebody they know? 43%? Hands up for 43%. Okay, so 43% of graduates get their first job through somebody they know. Anybody for 24%? Handful, yeah. 16? 9? Okay. Thankfully, it's not 43%. And also, thankfully, it's not 9%. 9% is actually typically the number of graduates who will go into what's known as a graduate scheme. So all the big recruiters campaigns, all the big careers fairs you go to, about 9% of all graduates will go into those schemes. Roughly a quarter, 25%, will get their first job through somebody they know. Now this is not somebody they know giving them a job, okay? That is not what this is about. This is somebody they know giving them enough information to get their first job. And that's different. And networking is actually about that. It's about thinking about building up your contacts, not necessarily they're going to give you a job, but they will give you information that'll help you. And that's about developing what's known as commercial awareness, and is incredibly important. So after this event, you'll be relieved to know there was lovely, lovely, lovely food in the Woolly Room. Woolly? Yep. One of those rooms on the card. You'll find it. You'll smell the food. And you should have the chance then to speak to these great speakers and to actually begin to understand, again, a little bit more about what they do and how it might relate to you. So what should you ask them? Any ideas? How about,
yeah?
Would you give me a job? Now, before you guys panic, this is what's going through their head. Yes, I will absolutely put my professional reputation on the line to give a job to a complete stranger. Okay? The chances are very, very, very low that you're going to get a job by asking somebody outright, will you give me a job, quite like that. So this is about keeping your expectations level, okay? These guys, you're off the hook, okay? So what can you get from them? Information and advice, okay? And when we do training sessions in the career service, DSM careers, on networking, we look at this in a lot more detail. Information is actually about the role itself. What do you do? What does actually being an accountant mean? How do you spend your day? What are the promotional prospects like? Advice is much more pertinent to you. It's about, I'm doing this course, what advice would you give me? So can you take one, you have some on? So information is about the job, the sector, building your knowledge. Advice might be slightly more specific to you. In a networking session like today, in reality, information is probably where you're going to find the conversation tends to sit. And that's fine. For those of you who are nervous about networking, it's okay, it's understandable. I'm passing around a handout with some good starter questions for you, okay? It might just give you some idea of how you might enter into conversation with somebody you haven't met before, like that. Okay? So I just wanted to wrap up my short slot by saying have a fantastic afternoon, okay? You're going to hear get an awful lot of information from this afternoon. If you're trying to decide what to do with that information and how it relates to you as an individual, come and see us in the Career Centre. We are in the LRC on the first floor. We can provide one-to-one appointments. We do help with psychometric testing, application CVs, pretty much everything. And we're also on all the social networks, so LinkedIn, Twitter, Facebook. And very active on those too. So if you haven't already joined us on those networks, we have posters around the room and around the corridors, so just scan in QR codes and you'll find us there. Thank you very much, and I wish you the best success.
Thank you, Andrew. Okay, our next guest that we will be inviting to the stage is a director, Market Issuer Risk Manager for International Treasury Desk. He works for Bank of America Merrill Lynch and he's been there for 41 years. The topic you'll be talking about today is an insight on risk. So could I please invite Mr. Philip Seeger to the stage, please?
My name is Phil Seeger. I've worked for Bank of America for a very long time, nearly 42 years now. So I'm actually older than the Greenwich School of Management. Moses was very generous in saying that I was a seasoned professional, or maybe he was just describing someone in general seasoned professional. I think what he really meant was that I'm an old professional. So I'm at the end of my career, effectively. But I'm still enjoying working in the industry I do, which is banking. Let me tell you a little bit about Bank of America and my role in it. Bank of America is an international bank. It's a world bank. It covers the full range of banking services. So it does everything that you would expect a retail or a commercial or a wholesale or an international bank to do. So, you know, typically we do the bread and butter stuff in the States, which is a large part of our income. Is taking deposits from depositors and lending it to people like homeowners to buy it for mortgages and to buy cars and all the rest of that stuff. So we do all that very basic banking stuff, and that's a very big part of our business. But we also do all the other stuff involved, like making commercial loans to companies so that companies can continue to work, they have working capital, and we work with them for their financing needs. So if they want a loan and they're a good credit, then we give them a loan. If they need to raise money by issuing securities, then we'll arrange that securities issuance for them, whichever is the best way to suit the customer. In doing that, we take fees, we take spreads, etc., which make the return for us reasonable. We also do all the normal stuff you expect of big international banks, big global banks. We do mergers and acquisitions, where we advise on the purchase and sale of companies and what companies might well be merged, and benefits for shareholders. We do trading in terms of running an investment bank, where we trade in fixed income markets, the equities markets, the foreign exchange markets, and the credit markets generally. Now, when I say trade, I have to be a little bit careful these days, because trade is, after the 2000 credit liquidity crisis, trade is a little bit of a dirty word. What we do is we have positions in these markets. And typically, the way that we have these positions these days is we have them in terms of building customer inventory. So what you used to have in banking, and again, it's a dirty word these days in many US banks, is proprietary trading. But what a bank would do is go out and bet its own capital in order to make money by taking out loan positions. That now is kind of outlawed under the new US regulations following the crisis. So we typically don't do that type of activity in the type of banking we are, nor do the other big international banks. But let me just, again, describe a little bit about risk, about what a bank actually does. Banks make money by taking risk. That's what we do, that's our function. If we didn't take risk, our returns would be very poor, and it probably wouldn't be worth running the business. So you've got to get used to the concept that banks like taking risk. That's what we do. And it's managing that risk and mitigating that risk so that the shareholder gets a reasonable return and gets a reasonably safe return. That's what a bank does. That's its core function. I mean, we could, if we wanted, just take deposits from customers on one side, pay them a rate, lend it for them to buy a house or a car, take a small spread in between. So we lend it at a slightly higher rate, take a small spread or margin in between. That margin isn't enough to cover the cost of our capital. So that doesn't give us a reasonable return that we need to get in order to be economically viable. So we need to get more from it, and that's what banks do. Banks do that simple business, but then take additional risk in order to increment that basic income. My particular world is in the treasury world. So again, it's the core function of a bank. If you look at a treasury operation in a bank, what you have is the operation that says, this is right down to the basics, can we finance ourselves? We're making loans here, we're making them to customers, we're making them to corporations, we're making them by taking trading positions. We need to finance these by having the cash to finance them. Can we do that? And that's the core function of the bank. That's what all banks do, whether it's Barclays or HSBC or Bank of America or the smallest bank you see on the high street. All banks have that core basic function. And that's the world I live in, where our main function is to make sure that the bank is liquid, that we always have enough cash on hand to cover our requirements, our obligations. So that's the kind of world that I work in, the very, very conservative part. Again, it's not the sexy investment type banking that you read about in the newspapers. It's not the retail bank in the US. It's the core treasury function of making sure that the cash flow works. And as many of you will find if you go into any form of business, whether it's a bank or whether it's you set up your own companies, your private company, cash flow is the single most important thing. So, you know, you can be making, just as a very, let me step aside, as a company or as an individual, you can very easily make profit. You know, assuming you've got your calculations right, and you've got your business model right, etc., and the economics right, making a profit can come reasonably straightforwardly. Many companies, and the majority of companies that go bankrupt, they're not go bankrupt because they're not making a profit. They're making profits. What they go bankrupt, or the reason they go bankrupt, is effectively that they can't finance their bills. So they're getting the bills coming in for the electricity, from their suppliers, invoices, etc., for the payments of their salaries. When they come to the end of the month and they try and meet these bills, they can't meet them. If you can't meet your cash bills, if your current account is in deficit, and you can't get an overdraft, you're busted. You may be making a very healthy P&L, but you're still busted, you're out of business. So managing cash flow is inherent to any activity, any business activity that you'll be engaged in. And it's probably the single most important activity in managing business. So, and that's what my world does, is it looks after those cash flows. But I actually work for the risk organisation. And so, as you can guess, by working for the risk organisation, my role is to look at the risk you run and say, can I quantify that risk? So can I convert that risk that we run into metrics that people will understand and that will allow us to say whether the risk we run is reasonable? And we can then mitigate that risk by hedging it or taking offsetting positions or offloading the positions to somebody else. And we can report it so we can make sure everybody's aware of the risk, so that nobody is blindsided by risk that's been taken that's unknown. You know, that's the very worst situation you can get into in the bank, is when suddenly out of left field you get an event that completely blindsides you. It blindsides you not because it may be completely sudden and you weren't expecting it, but it's blindsided you as well because you haven't prepared for it. You should have prepared for it and you haven't prepared for it. So in the risk organisation, we tend to categorise risks in many ways. There's many different types of risk. So if I just go through some of the basic types of risk. So for example, let me just read out a list of the risks to you, and you'll get an idea of the comprehensive nature of them. So we have strategic risk, credit risk, market risk, liquidity risk, operational risk, compliance risk, and reputational risk, all of which are managed by teams of professionals. Now my actual role is to look after market risk and issue risk. So that I have two of those areas in the treasury world. And, you know, my group, let's say, I look after our risk in Asia, Europe, Latin America, and Canada. And we have maybe three people working on it. So we have a very small team. Reasonable amount of risk, but a very small team working on it. If I look at our global markets business, which is what people would describe as the investment banking part of the business, then that has multiple numbers of people. So it's a much bigger operation. They have much bigger risks and exposures to manage. They employ numbers. You know, if you looked at our risk organisation in total, in Bank of America, it runs into the thousands of people. And that was ramped up extremely fast from 2007 with the credit crisis and the liquidity crisis, because banks realised, regulators realised, politicians realised that banks weren't doing their job to the world in this world. So, you know, you've seen a lot of redundancies in the banking industry over the last 5 years. Well, it's turning around now. But where you never saw redundancies was in the risk area. You know, there were no redundancies in risk, whether it was market risk or issuer risk or compliance risk. Those areas are in more demand than they were in 2007, simply because the banks did such a bad job prior to that in managing risk. So, you know, the regulators have come to us and said, if you want to carry on doing business, you've got to manage that bit and that risk more effectively. You've got to show us that you can manage it properly. And one of the ways, of course, you do that is by hiring more people. To get more metrics, to get more confidence, the numbers that you're producing and the risk evaluation that you're doing is good. So, you know, our industry has been a growth industry. If you looked at the number of people we employed at risk in London in 2007 compared to today, it's probably gone up by 75% or 100%. and that's been replicated in all the other investment banks and commercial banks around the world. They're all in exactly the same situation. So let me talk a little bit about the risks that I look after, which is market risk and issuer risk. Market risk is effectively in a bank. It says, you know, it's the risk of a market moving against you. So it says, I have positions in these markets, I hold inventory in these markets. If the value of this inventory in these positions goes down, I lose money. If the value of the positions goes up, I make money. Obviously, in terms of risk, you're only interested really in looking at the negative side. You're interested in looking at the downside. If the upside's great, that's good, no problem. Downside is what the shareholders are in. And so what we're looking at in market risk is the risk that market prices, be they equities or loans, foreign exchange or house prices, actually go against you in the market. And banks can be two-way round. Sometimes you can be long the asset or the asset, and sometimes you can be short the asset. So you know you can be both sides of that market. So you can have a position where you're short the asset or long the asset. So we're looking at the downside. And the reason we do that is because what our role is to quantify potentially on the downside, if things went against us using statistical analysis, if things went against us in the market, how much of our capital would it cost us? So a lot of the stuff we do is very finance oriented, it's very mathematical and statistics based. And it says, you know, our basic measure we call value at risk. And what value at risk says is, at a certain confidence level, how much could you expect to lose based on past history and the current positions that you're holding that you have in the book? And so it analyses your positions and says, well, let's look at what happened over the last period. So maybe we take a 3-year history. And we look at all the markets that we're active, we look at all the products that we trade in, all the maturity tenders that we trade in, and we look at how rates in all those markets are moved, whether equities or fixed income, government bonds, etc. How rates move during that 3-year period. And we look at how they moved on a day-to-day basis over that 3-year period. And we say, okay, let's take, we use a 99% confidence level and a 1-day assumption that we can sell the position. Using those assumptions, how much would it cost us if the negative cases occurred? And so what we do is we come up with a number that quantifies, and we call it our value at risk number, which quantifies on a 99% probability using 3-year history and a 1-day liquidity horizon how much money we could lose on a single day. Now we could also lose that following day and the following day and the following day. So we take that into account. But what we then do is we then convert that value at risk number, the amount of money that we might expect to lose based on past history, past experience, we then convert that into how much the bank's capital could be lost. And so what we end up with when we do that across all our businesses is a number that we can present to our management and our shareholders and our board of directors that says, when we come into business today, we're pretty sure that 99 days out of 100, we won't lose more today than this amount. And that amount will be then deducted from our capital. So what our board and our managing committees can say is, well, we're comfortable if you guys lose $250 million in 1 day. Now, if you lose $250 million, you know, if a bank's got $50 billion of capital, losing $200 million isn't going to bankrupt us. It's not going to cause us too much trouble. So maybe we set a limit of $250 million. And then what we do is we then tell our traders, you can manage positions, you can hold positions, but if the risk on those positions, based on past experience, shows that we could lose more than $250 million, we don't want that. You know, we want you to reduce your positions, cut your positions, so that we are keeping our risk appetite at a level we're comfortable with. And so that's kind of market risk. So it's the risk that the value of your positions changes in an adverse way. So that's my primary. So I do that quantification of how much we could lose. We do lots of things like stress testing as well, where we take extreme events. So, you know, from the 2007 credit card crisis onwards, we go through We select periods where there were extreme market dislocations, where the markets functioned dysfunctionally for periods of time. And we look at those worst case scenarios and also say, well, okay, you know, we've looked already at 99% short confidence level balance we could lose on one day, liquidity rising. How about if the markets moved against us for three solid weeks of extreme moves? How much could we then lose? And where you have a number of maybe 50 million you might lose on a one-day basis, that number may aggregate up to $1 billion if you look at a complete market event over a time period. And then, of course, you're saying to your board of directors and your risk management group, now, are you comfortable with losing $1 billion over a three-week period? And $1 billion might start making people think a bit more about whether they're really comfortable with losing $1 billion over that period. And we run lots of these stress scenarios for different type of markets and market events, some of which have actually occurred in the past, so they're real, they actually happened in history, and some of which we postulate. So we come up with our own hypothetical scenarios which we create, in which they, you know, if these events occur, what could we lose? So we manage again around stress scenarios very heavily these days, much more since 2007. And then we have issuer risk, which effectively is part of credit risk. Credit risk generally is pretty straightforward. So credit risk says a bank's lending money to you and you don't repay me. That's a risk. The risk is that you don't repay me. So when I'm lending to you money, what I'm going to do is I'm going to assess you. I'm going to see what your salary is, what your ability is to repay is, what assets you've got that I can get hold of if you do default, etc. I'm going to do all that type of analysis and figure out whether you can repay me. So that's basic credit risk. So you've already got two big risks, or two of the big risks, which is market risk, that the value of your positions is going to change in a detrimental way, it can go down. It's just like you're buying a house. If the house, you buy it for $100,000 and the value of the house falls next year by £20,000, you've lost £20,000, that's actually the same for a bank when it holds securities or loans or any others. Credit risk, the risk that you won't be paid what I give you. So we have teams of analysts with completely different skill sets. I mean, the credit analysts will be very different skill sets of people to the market risk analysts. You look at market risk analysts, they're going to be, typically going to be very quant-based. So they're going to be comfortable handling large amounts of data and doing statistical analysis. So, you know, maths is a real key skill in our world. And being able to handle huge amounts of data is also a big skill. So IT being really good with IT skills is also absolutely essential. You know, we expect our risk managers to be able to code in VBA. We expect them to be able to do code in all the normal languages and to go away and write their own programs and applications to support the mainframe type stuff we also do. But kind of we expect all those things. So you've already got those two risks. And then you have a third one, which is liquidity risk, which I referred to at the beginning. And liquidity risk in many ways is the most fundamental of all, because it's said, if you haven't got enough money on hand, it's pay bills, your buses, and that goes for a bank or anybody else. Even a private individual, that's equally true of everybody. So liquidity risk, you know, you saw it in 2007, 2008 very heavily with Northern Rock in the UK, with HBOS, with Lehman's, all companies which couldn't pay their bills in the UK. And you know, it's interesting if you look at banks like Northern Rock, people like this, what they were doing in their model of funding, they thought they had a secure funding model. What they were doing was borrowing in the short-term money markets, and this is short-term money markets are effectively a market between banks. So some banks have money, some to lend, some banks have money they can borrow, two come together in the interbank lending market. Now, that interbank lending market for many, many generations has been very healthy, very solid, very liquid, so that banks could lend to each other with a fair certainty of getting their money back. And so liquidity flowed from people who had it to people who needed it. It worked very well. 2007, that whole relationship unraveled, because suddenly no other bank that you traded with was safe. You couldn't lend money to them without the fear, very real fear, that the following day they might be bankrupt and wouldn't repay it to you. So effectively the interbank lending market shut up. It's just shut up shop completely. And banks like Northern Rock and HBOS, in terms of funding their loan portfolios and their mortgage portfolios, What they've done is taken a very short-term view. They say money markets will always be there. They'll never close. We'll always have that source of liquidity. When we want money, we just go in and borrow it from Barclays, Bank of America or something else. So they sourced a huge amount of their lending to their customers for mortgages from the wholesale money market. Probably 40%, 50% of their borrowing came from money markets. Now what other banks were doing was different banks who lent mortgages. Banks like Barclays and Lloyds, what they were doing, they were saying, yeah, we'll take some money from the money markets, but we won't make it too big a portion. So maybe we'll take 10%, 15% of our requirements from the money market. The rest of it we'll take from our depositors. So you put money in the bank in your current account, I'll use that money to lend somebody else. So you had these two completely different spheres of banks with two different models. One saying we'll rely on our retail depositors to fund our loans, our portfolios. And the other one saying, no, we won't rely on retail depositors. We don't have them. We don't have enough of them. We want to make a lot of loans, but we haven't got enough deposits coming in from Joe Bloggs on the street to finance them. So what we do is we go to the wholesale money markets. They're always going to be there. You know, they'll always provide cash to us. And of course, when the crunch came, and people's credit, banks' credit started deteriorating, and of course, those wholesale money markets disappeared. So banks like HBOS, Northern Rock, just couldn't raise money. They were effectively, they shut down because the money markets wouldn't lend the money anymore.
So what happens to the customers who are the customers of those banks?
Well, the customers of those banks were okay because the government took over. So the government stepped in and said, we'll finance those mortgages instead of Northern Rock and HBOS. Now, one of the things about the government is when it comes to mortgages and people lending money and that activity, be it a retail activity, the government is extremely sensitive. It can't be seen to be allowing people, ordinary guys on the street, to be hit by the banking crisis. So it will always protect those. Or it will always make its best effort to protect those. And that's what you saw. So the government stepped in, took over the mortgage block, etc. And that model was fundamentally flawed. So the model that Northern Rock was following and HBOS was following was fundamentally flawed and shouldn't have been in place in the first place. And to some extent, you can blame the regulators for that. You know, the regulators were fully aware of that model and they said nothing. They assumed it, they went along with it and said no problem at all. So the regulators got egg on their face. Northern Rock's management got egg on their face because they completely misunderstood the markets. The banking industry generally got egg on its face. Very heavily. Politicians got their egg on their face because politicians were encouraging, or at least not discouraging, banks from doing all these things. So politicians were well aware of what was going on and made no real efforts to stop it. We have something, and the other US banks probably, and I speak generally about US banks because that's what I'm most familiar with, but we have something like $400 billion of surplus liquidity. So we have $400 billion sitting in our bank accounts that we can't lend at the moment. Commercial companies, whether they're customers in the US or international, or whether they're retail customers, you know, ordinary guys on the street in the US, are not borrowing that heavily. So we have all this surplus cash sitting there. What do? We place it with the central bank. Okay. Can't place it with other banks anymore, because that market is still effective. So you place it all with the central bank. So, you know, this $400 billion, or most of it, gets placed straight back to the Federal Reserve Bank in the US every day on an overnight basis, and they place interest rate on a very small. And that's the way it is. And if you look at what Deutsche Bank are doing, Barclays are doing, they all have exactly the same position. Huge amounts of cash which they're just lending straight back to SMEs. Because the borrowing, the actual borrowers are not there. In terms of, but also a little bit of lenders not necessarily lend so easily now. Their credit criteria have become more strict. And that's again another feature that you see of the 2007-2010 crisis is that leading up to that, banks relaxed their lending pricing. So over the previous 10 years, there had been no dislocations of any form in the credit markets, really. So banks became more and more comfortable with lending more and more money at smaller and smaller margins. So the return got smaller, but banks were still willing to do it because it was safe. Effectively, what they were doing was ignoring basic fundamental credit quality criteria. Saying, you know, as long as we churn enough of this stuff out, even though it's a lower trading return, because we're doing so much of it, we're still making reasonable returns. It's like Tesco, you know, selling lots of stuff in the high street, you know, in the supermarket, compared to maybe Waitrose, who sell less stuff but high quality. All banks really reduce, or most banks, many banks, reduce their credit quality, their credit provision, their credit assessment. And that was another fundamental factor behind the credit crisis, the liquidity crisis. Banks have re-established those credit crises, banks became fundamental again, and now say, you know, you go to your local bank, for example, and ask for a mortgage now. Now if you went and asked for a mortgage 5-6 years ago before the credit crisis, they'd say, okay, we'll give you a 95% mortgage, we'll give you 100% mortgage. Some of them would say we'll give you 120% mortgage. You know, those days are long gone. You go to a bank now in the UK and say, I have a mortgage, they say, yeah, we've got 25%. So the 100% mortgages are gone, 125% mortgages are gone. You know, if you want to pay interest only these days again, that's very much more difficult than it used to be, because banks have tightened their credit criteria. They got hurt badly, and they've reassessed how they lend and come to conclusions. But we also have very general risks that we classify as risks. So things like, for example, compliance risks. So compliance risk simply says, do we as a bank conform to the regulations that we're supposed to conform to that are set by local regulators, wherever they are in the world? And if you don't conform to those, typically, you get fined, and your business gets severely disrupted. So, you know, if you look at a problem like compliance, what you may say is, you know, for example, the examples in the last year, 2 years, of a couple of major British banks in America fined very heavily. You know, in total fines were approaching $2 billion on the one side, not having strong enough anti-money laundering processes in place, so that drug barons, etc., in South America were able to launder their profits through the bank. And the other one was where one of, again, this is a British bank, was where the British bank was not conforming to US regulations on trading with Iran. And Iran is on what the Americans call the OFAC list. And what it is basically a list of countries that American companies and companies operating in America are not allowed to trade with. Iran features very prominently in that list. And this particular bank was facilitating trades with Iran, was alleged to. And the US government found out eventually and said, you guys have broken the rules, you know, these are the rules, you're not supposed to do that. So they fined very heavily. So you have those types of compliance risks, which can be extremely expensive. Then you have things like strategic risk. And strategic risk is more conceptual. What it says is, we have a business, we want to expand that business. We didn't trade commodities in the past 20 years, but we want to trade commodities now. So we want to go into a new line of business. Maybe we want to do a strategic merger, we want to buy something. Maybe we want to merge with something. All those strategic decisions carry a degree of risk. If you don't do enough due diligence on who you buy, who you're merging with, and you find out after you've merged that you didn't do the due diligence, you didn't look at the books, you didn't assess the cash flow, you didn't assess what was in that company's positions, you find out afterwards suddenly your P&L, your profit and loss account, is blown completely. So you have, you know, you have decisions that are made which can potentially go wrong. And it's typically, very typically, decisions that, you know, are made at a very senior level in the company about strategic direction, which the company can get wrong, but you have to assess those risks and see what they are. And you have things like operational risk. And banks these days are just huge machines that churn out loans and everything else. So, you know, we're a factory. We're probably the biggest factory in the world in every bank. We have huge computing power to process the number of transactions that we handle. And they're going into the millions, tens of millions every day. And the amounts are ginormous involved. And of course, if any of those processes fail, you lose money. You know, if your settlement systems fail and you can't make a delivery to a customer or to a commercial customer, which affects their business, the customer hasn't got money because you were due to give it to him, he hasn't got it. Somebody's got to pay for that. And of course, the customer comes back to the bank and says, you're going to compensate me for my loss. So, you know, again, in the UK in the last year or two, you've seen one of the major UK banks having major problems with its settlement and clearing systems and getting in a big trouble because of that. So you have this operational risk that your systems will break down, that your processes will break down, people won't perform their duties correctly, and you will suffer financial losses as a result. So again, we have a whole process to make sure that we can get comfortable with that type of risk. Reputational risk. To a bank, you know, the whole foundation of a bank is trust. Your customers who are borrowing from you have to trust you. The customers who are placing money with you have to trust you. It's inherent to a bank. The bank and its customers have trust, and the customers essentially trust the bank. So your reputation in the market is extremely important to you. It's not something that you easily put at risk. So whenever we're looking at anything we do, anything that's new or change in what we do, what we say is, could this have an impact on our reputation? How will the public perceive it? How will the press receive it? How will the politicians receive it? The worst thing for a bank is to be on the news at 10. You know, if you see a bank's name, Bank of America comes up on the news at 10 as the first item on the headline. It says Bank of America has done this, and it's negative. You know, our management start to have heart attacks because that is doing an untold amount of damage to our brand and to our reputation. And if customers don't trust banks, they don't put money with it, they don't deal with it. So our reputation is extremely important to us in terms of maintaining it. But I've said an awful lot about the type of risks that a bank runs in its normal course of business, but what do we do about it? You know, yeah, so we've run all those risks, how do we get comfortable? Well, what we do to get comfortable with those risks is we have processes around them that we hope will give us a good feel for whether we can manage those risks appropriately. So the first thing we do is in our risk framework, we have something called IMMR. The I stand in for identify. First of all, identify what the risk is. So you have to be able to identify and say what that risk is so that you know what you're talking about, you know what you're looking at. The second thing you have to be able to do is measure the risk. So once you've identified you've got a risk, you have to be able to say, how do I quantify it? You know, what metrics can I look at that will tell me what risk I'm running? You know, you can't just have a conversation with me and say I'm running a risk of losing some money. I want to know more than that. I want to know how much money I'm going to lose. Now, you tell me how much money I can lose and what the circumstances will be and what the parameters are, and then I can make an informed judgment about whether I'm comfortable or not at risk. So we have the measure. The third item we have is mitigate, which says, okay, we see these risks, we understand, we've measured them, we can quantify them, we know what they are. How do we mitigate any risks that we see? Should we mitigate? Should we not mitigate? So typically banks will assume risk in their normal course of business and will try to mitigate or hedge that risk out, or some of it out. You don't want to hedge it all out, but you will want to typically reduce that risk by passing it to somebody else or reducing it through other transactions. So mitigation is a very important basis for what we do. And then you have report, which simply says that once we understand all these other things, we've got comfortable with them, let's actually tell people what they are. Let's actually write a report. Let's actually document it and say, these are the risks. Do we find it acceptable? Let's discuss it in-house. Let's have a debate. Let's figure out whether we want to do it. And that's the bank. That's the process banks go through all the time. So I hope that gives you a little bit of a better idea of risk. Now, in terms of employment, as I say, risk generally is typically going to be a role where you have to have good quantitative type IT type skills. That's a basic groundwork that you come from. Math skills, especially on things like market risk, are very important. You are handling large amounts of data, you are doing a lot of statistical type work, you are developing models that look at how the world and how macroeconomic situation is changing, and try to postulate how that would affect your business. So you do need those skills. But we also need people who are team players. You know, they've got to be team players. We work as a small group. You have to trust everybody. You have to be very collegiate in the way you work. So team players, people with good personalities, people who are bright, put themselves forward. You know, what often we want to see when we're interviewing prospective candidates is we want to see the guys who stand out from the other guys. Yeah. So you get 10 people come in, you give them all a series of tasks to do. Maybe all 10 do the tasks very similarly, but it's the way they do the tasks. You know, the ones who are enthusiastic the ones who put the effort in, the ones who make an effort to explain to you what they're doing and push themselves forward. Those are the guys that typically are going to get noticed, the girls that typically are going to get noticed. So, you know, as Andrew was saying, you know, networking is extremely important. You know, you have to know how to relate to people, and you have to relate to them well. Not only to your boss, it's the people who work for you, but the people who work alongside you, your colleagues, so that you work in a very collegiate type way. So all those types of skills are very, very necessary. But we, you know, Bank of America is no different from the other big international banks. We have a website, we have extensive internship type programs and careers programs that go throughout the year. Typically for internships and things like that, we're looking in the next few months maybe at the internship and the training and the enrollment for next year. But you know, I'd recommend that you go to the Bank of America careers website, go to the Citibank one and the Deutsche Bank one as well. These are all good banks, Barclays. And have a look at their websites. And you really will be surprised to see how inclusive they are, that they're very happy to bring people along to interview you and to look at your skills and see whether they fit in with the organisation. So, I've probably gone past my time.
We're now going to have Heather Katsonga Woodward come and give a speech. She's an author and online entrepreneur. She's a former investment banker. She spent 2 years in IBD and Goldman Sachs and 5 years in derivatives structuring at HSBC. One of her books focuses on how to get into investment banking. She will focus her talk on how to get into investment banking with a bit about running your own business. So could I please invite Heather?
Hey guys, I'm Heather. I was very glad when I walked in here to see a group of people of probably a similar background to myself. Immigrants, basically. I came to Britain in 2002 on a full scholarship to Cambridge. And I've always wanted to be a business person, and I always knew when I was in university that I wanted to be a business person. But I'm going to spend some time talking about what I've done to give you an idea of probably what you can do, and why I did banking first and why I quit, and then you can decide for yourself what you want to do. When I graduated, I wanted to stay in Britain, but as an immigrant, you can't just stay in Britain. I'm sure you guys probably know that already, and it's much worse these days. In my day, when you came for university, when you arrived at the airport, they stamped 3 years in your passport, and you were free. Nowadays, every year you have to apply or something like that. So upon my graduation, let me go back a little bit. I did an internship at Goldman Sachs in my second year, and that was actually crucial in me getting a job at Goldman Sachs, because the vast majority of people that they hire come off the internship program. In my division, I think they only hired about 10 people. I was in the financing group in IBD, which is basically a hybrid group between corporate finance and the capital markets, and 9 out of 10 of us had been interns. I thought I would only work in banking for 6 or 7 years, because that's exactly how long it took to get a British passport. And incidentally, that's exactly what I did. People said, you know, once you reach that point, you'll be so addicted to the money in banking, you won't be able to quit. But you know what? I had no trouble whatsoever. I was focused. I saved a lot. I knew exactly what business I was going to start. So 9 months before I quit, I actually put in my diary, "You're resigning that day." And I actually went in a day early. Have any of you done internships? You all graduate this year?
Yeah.
Some next year?
Yeah.
Well, if we'd met 6 months ago, I would have been telling you, make sure you're applying for internships so that this summer you are on some sort of graduate scheme. Because since the credit crunch, banks have been very limited in terms of how many people they can hire, and they give priority to those people that have done their internships because they've had the experience of monitoring them for 10 weeks or so. you still have a good chance, so I wouldn't give up hope. But the crucial thing in making an application is doing a lot of research. Part-time right now, I do investment banking coaching, but I haven't been actually doing this a lot now because I ended up, quite by accident, doing a business that's done a lot better than the coaching. So I focus a lot of my time not on investment banking coaching now, but on running my online retail business. A lot of applications I get from people that do want to get in banking are usually not well sculpted, not well researched, and people generally haven't spent the sort of time that they should in making that application. If you want to work in investment banking, for every application I recommend, you spend 2 or 3 hours reading up about the bank, their website, their annual report, and making sure you have a good feel for the business before you even put pen to paper. You should read any bios that are online on the bank's website. You should be able to say very specific things about the bank when you make your application. So I'm going to use Goldman Sachs as my example, because that was ultimately the bank that I got into, and I can explain exactly what I was writing in order to be an attractive candidate for an interview. I was cruising through the Goldman Sachs website, and everything I read sort of always went back to their business principles. They've got 14 business principles which they hold dearly, or at least according to the website, they said they hold dearly. So I made sure I learned what the business principles were before my first interview. But even in making my application, I was correlating the skills that I have with their business principles. And that's the sort of thing that you should be able to do. When you're making your application, you should be able, you shouldn't just say, I'm very hardworking. It's very generic. Everyone's going to say they're hardworking. Everyone's going to say they'll give 101%, 110%. Everyone talks about how they were top of their class and so forth. But what the bank wants is evidence. So give examples of jobs that you've done. It can even be charitable jobs. Give an example of something you did in university, but even better, things that you did outside of university. Within a sporting team, I had a friend who was applying to, I think it was Fidelity at the time, and he had an example of something that he'd done outside of work, looking after children with disabilities, and he thought it wasn't a good idea to use examples from this. But I was like, are you crazy? That's perfect. People who are reading through these cover letters and applications get so bored because everybody's saying exactly the same thing. So if you say something that's slightly different, and if it shows that a skill that they want, and in his case, it showed problem solving when something had gone wrong, that's the perfect kind of example to use. So don't just list. When you make your application forms, they will ask you questions regarding, give me 3 examples of when you were challenged, or give me your top 3 qualities. Give me 2 things that someone who knows you would say about you. They don't want a list. Anybody can write a list. They want substantiated examples, and that's what you have to give them if you plan on getting the job. Furthermore, there's some people, well, a lot of people are very busy, so you're in a rush and you will inevitably make mistakes. Give your application to somebody you trust to read through thoroughly to make sure you haven't made any silly typos, because these just make you look bad. There's some applications that come through flawless, not a single typo, and that will make that person look slightly better than you, even if they don't have the experiences that you do. So you don't want any sort of typos on your application. Writing an application in good time, like as one of the first candidates, is a good idea. And because a lot of investment banks do close the application processes in January to February, you should probably at the moment be looking at more independent and smaller niche banks and finance companies, hedge funds, apply out of cycle, other financial institutions like investment managers will tend to leave the application process a little bit longer. Of the people that I was coaching for internships that will be happening from June, July until September, the first person got their job last October. So that just shows you how much in advance they start looking for candidates. If they've been applying, if you have been applying in September, October 2012 for an internship or a full-time job this year, and they've been getting those jobs, the pipeline is being filled up. They're probably 80% filled up by now, and you're chasing 20% of the jobs available. So you should be looking to make applications now, tonight. You should be doing your research tonight. At this point, I'm going to talk a little bit about my book, To Become an Investment Banker. My plan for the book was, it wasn't really a money-making plan. It was more, I've been given this great opportunity to work at really great investment banks, and I've done both corporate finance and derivatives, so I've worked in both sides of an investment bank that new applicants are generally looking to go into. So I felt like it's my civic duty, because when I applied, I didn't have connections to ask. I'm from Malawi in Africa. I didn't know at the time anybody in an investment bank. So I couldn't have depended on connections to get me the job. So in my book, I detail exactly what investment banks are looking for in a candidate, the sort of questions you can expect to receive, how to answer those questions to look good and to look better than other candidates that have applied for the same job. And I give you a few tips on what to do to hit the ground running when you actually start. I haven't bought any copies today of my book because it wasn't a sales event. In fact, after this, I'll send an email to Dami and I can give you guys copies, £5 a copy for the next week. It's $14.99 or £12 online. $14.99, that's dollars. So that's what I talk about in my book. Has anybody made an application to investment banking? And by the way, I need to leave promptly at 3, so if there's any questions that you want to ask about what I'm saying, you can ask as you go. Yeah?
Yeah,
I've made. Yeah, and have you heard back?
Unfortunately, I think I took my test at the wrong time because I was way too tired at 1 a.m, so that was a serious mistake.
Oh, so you're tired and...
I took a test and I had work the next morning, so I was like, rushed because they sent me an email to quickly take the test.
And
I didn't finish because time ran out.
Ooh. How many questions were in the test?
I think it's about 22 minutes, allowed 18 minutes, something like that.
And were you tired when you were writing it?
I was tired, yeah. And time ran out very quickly, so probably had done about 11 minutes or so.
Which bank was this?
Deutsche Bank.
So after the test, they said you're not going through to the next round.
They sent me an email the next day that said, unfortunately, I'll not be able to make it.
Oh, sorry. See, that's one tip. If you're going to be doing any aptitude tests online, make sure you're wide awake. In fact, the best time to do them is as soon as you wake up in the morning, because that's when you're probably sharpest and are going to be thinking straight. If you are applying for a non-graduate position, let's say a position in front office where you just need to send your cover letter and a CV, they would normally require experience, and experience in the financial sector. So when I moved from IBD to derivative sales, I didn't actually have sales experience, but I had banking experience. And I went through a headhunter. So if you're above 30, speak to headhunters. They might be able to help you. If you have relevant experience, which is usually experience in some other technical field, that could work for you. So for instance, if you're gonna work on the natural resources team and you worked as an engineer at a premier corporate company, even though you have no finance experience, no banking experience, but have very valid engineering experience and can probably easily form a relationships with senior management in companies of that type, then you have a good chance. However, if you've just been in the education system for a long time doing jobs that don't actually build up the skills you need to be a VP or an MD in an investment bank, that is going to be a problem for you. I'm not going to lie about it. It's going to be a big problem. I've just been told that you do have a Q&A session at the end of this, so I don't need to actually be asking questions. However, I find an interactive session where I'm talking and people are asking me questions much more useful, because I know about the problems that you're facing or you want to know about, and I just enjoy interacting with people. the reason I quit investment banking, there was one thing that investment banking didn't satisfy, which I felt my life needed to have, which was flexibility and freedom. I'm passionate about finance and I enjoy financial concepts, and I actually enjoyed working in the financial industry and got on with my colleagues. But I also want to be the type of person that can go on holiday anytime I want without filling in an application form to somebody and just has, you know, lots of things going on. I always knew I wasn't the sort of person who wants a career that lasts years and years in one bank. That's just not me. I'm someone who likes to experience different things. So I quit in April last year. I went into my manager and said, can we have a meeting? And he said, yeah. And then I said, yeah, I'm leaving. He said, oh, can we do anything? I said, no. Because that was pretty much it. I decided. And what I thought I would be doing when I resigned was working on my coaching. So coaching for investment banking, and that would give me the flexibility I needed. And I was doing this, and there was some traction. There are people who write to me almost every day, most of them wanting me to look at their CVs for free. And how do you reply to those emails anymore? And then, just for fun, I was writing a blog on natural African hair, which is hair that doesn't have chemical relaxer. And I started writing my blog in about May last year, a month after I quit. I was on holiday in America, and I was just bored at the time that I started it. And it wasn't that focused, but a few months later in November, I thought, you know what, I'm going to start writing this blog a little bit more passionately, and I'll run this blog like a business. When I decided to do that, I got onto all the social networks, I created a Facebook page, and within about 10 days, I had 1,000 Facebook fans.
Wow.
I was like, shh, damn, that's a lot of Facebook fans. Maybe there's an opportunity here. So I started writing almost every day. I decided I'd create a product, and everything, momentum just kept building. And 6 months later, today I have just under 35,000 Facebook fans, about 900 Twitter fans. I've got a product. I'm making enough revenue for me to continue living. And by my projections, by the end of the year, I'll be making more revenue than I did salary in investment banking. So you never know what you can make money in. And what kind of egged me on is that my brother has an online business which he started last year, and he made six-figure profits.
Wow.
And if I told you what the business is, which I will not because I don't want him getting competition, you'd be like, oh yeah, okay, he does that. You would have no idea that in such a small thing, you can make that kind of money. And of course, as a single individual, you don't actually need that much to live. So for instance, I'm my only employee, but I contract a lot of services out. I've got a distributor, I've got a manufacturer, I don't make my own product. I've got a designer who makes all my labels for me. I love web design and I know HTML, so I enjoy building my own website, so I do that. And I just spend my time marketing on Facebook, Twitter, and writing my blogs. And it's surprising what you can do with the technology that is out there nowadays. If you have plans of having your own business, once you get your British passport, you should read Tim Ferriss's book, The 4-Hour Workweek. I thought it's marvelous. My brother thought it's rubbish, but I thought it's really good. And if you look at my blog, in fact, I'll send Dami a link to my blog because I've got all the business books I've read, and I think they're part of the reason I was able to just go into this business and make it a success almost right away, because I just read so much over the 6 months that, you know, I was lucky.
So please give a warm welcome to Dr. Peter Matabunti.
Ladies and gentlemen, how many of you have seen me before? Anybody seen me before? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I'm told I have about 64,000 followers on Twitter now. So, and then Facebook has about 100K. Means nobody in this room lost Facebook. It was exciting listening to the last speaker, because she bring to the close. She mentioned quite a few things that I think all of you should do naturally. Shouldn't even hear from her, by the way. Is there anybody in the house that has gone through a revolution before? Or participated in the revolution? Revolution one? What time of revolution, sir?
Well, my revolution is to change the perception of people towards making money.
Perception change in generating wealth. Now, how many of you have heard about Tunisia? Heard about Tunis?
Yeah.
How many of you have heard about Libya?
Yes.
How many of you have heard about... Probably, I think the best example is Egypt. How many of you have heard about Egypt? Now, without Facebook, without social media, the huge political upheaval we've seen in the Middle East would not have taken place. That would have taken quite 100 years for you to bring about a revolution. So if you have an email account, it's enough proof that you're participating in the biggest revolution in human history. Because technology is not just an enabler, it's also disruptive if you get into the wrong hands. And it's an enabler if you get into the right hands. The fact that everything I'm telling you now as I'm talking is being quote unquote webinar. So all my followers on Twitter, on Facebook, this morning I just tweeted I was going to be here. And yesterday I tweeted I was going to be somewhere else. And the sheer power of technology, the fact that I can type in 140 characters here in London, and people in Singapore will be seeing it, and people in Australia will see it at exactly the same time, you needed to be BBC or CNN to be able to do that. But that's called global broadcasting. And it cost them a few million pounds before they could do that. But you can do that from not just a computer. You know what's annoying? You can do it from what they told you is a mobile phone. They told you it's a mobile phone because the person that sold it to you doesn't know any better. If they knew the power of the phone, they won't be selling phones. They won't even be in retail. They'll be employing presidents to be their chauffeur. Want me to say that slowly? You know the president of the country, the biggest person? If you understand the power of your mobile phone, you can employ him as your cab driver, be your chauffeur. Now, what the young lady said just before I came, well, that's what I was saying to you. She was picking up on a few fundamental truths. Some of you might think she's just showing off. She isn't. She's just scratching one aspect of the sheer power you get economically if you are enabled. And no one can tell me that this is not the so-called weapon of mass destruction. You heard about looking for weapons of mass destruction? That's the weapon. And you see how he's done things in Libya? Go and read the Libya revolution again. See how he's done things in Egypt. And see what happened in Egypt before and after social media. And then you understand that we're just being entertained. If in 7 years' time, all of you that are hearing me now, are not multimillionaires, are failed, and you wasted your time. And I can head for the door. I'm not saying that to boost your confidence. I'm saying as a matter of fact, every one of you, 7 years after graduation, should be millionaires. If you are not, there's something wrong with your brain. So it's a matter of your thinking. It's not a matter of whether or not you can. And the mobile phone I have in my hands is even free. It was given to me free. All I needed was proof of residence. Do you understand how annoying it is? Because I got it free, I would not know the value. If I was asked to buy this phone, I couldn't buy it for £1 million. The only reason why you get phones like this is because of what they call Moore's Law. Please, when you leave here, can you write it down? M-O-O-R-E, Moore. That's what it's called, Moore's Law. Any computing science student in the house? Nobody's doing computer science. Yeah, if you heard about Moore's Law? Okay, next time, he's out in the canteen. Can you buy him his lunch? will tell you all about. Because Moore's law even predicted how frequently you will renew your contract. It says every 18 months, the power of your computing power doubles, the size shrinks, and the price is dropped. So if you don't know Moore's law, as soon as you came through this law, I took £2,000 out of your pocket. Because every 2 years, what happens to your computer? Remember, average, every 2 years, what happens to your computer? If they say you have to update it, or upgrade it, or get a new software, or get a new hardware. So if you understand the principles of Moore's law, you can turn the planet on its head. All right? For those of you that haven't seen me before, I just play you some of the clips that you should have seen. If you saw it, you probably will sleep less. I'll just play this. This is an old GMTV video.
Melvin, how are you at algebra?
Oh, I am so good. It is scary.
I never even understood why we did it.
It was that first bit, A plus B equals C. How does that work?
Which is a little excuse for being lousy at maths generally. So let me introduce you now to two people who certainly are, Paula and Peter Imhoff-Dodd. Their name. They've just passed the University of Cambridge Advanced Maths A level, and you've guessed it, they're just 8 years old. And I'm Chris and Sister Samantha is not half bad at maths herself, I have to say. Thanks very much indeed, all of you, for coming in. First of all, congratulations, you are now the world record holders for getting the youngest people ever to attain such an achievement. Well, very, very well done. Were you surprised when you heard that?
Yeah.
You were? You knew you were going to do well, didn't you?
Yeah.
How hard have you been working?
Well, I find it as a game, so it's not really hard.
Now, tell me about the sort of things you had to do in this exam, Peter.
Well, we had to look at some questions that may seem difficult, but are very easy once you just get in the swing of it.
I'll take your point, but I think I'm right in saying, Samantha, because you did this. How old were you when you passed your advanced
class? I'm nine.
You were nine, so they've beaten your record now. Right. But it's not just about taking your calculator into the classroom, as you can do these days, or adding up or multiplying, etc., etc., or even doing algebra. It's about mathematical reasoning.
Yes.
What is that?
It's one of it is kind of like using the process of elimination, so you don't have to think as hard as you would do in an A-level paper. So you could say three of the questions were right and one of them is wrong. So if you work out the first three and they're right, then you know straight away that the last one will be wrong.
I guess it's about really understanding that, isn't it? Rather than just adding up or multiplying or even doing algebra, it's about understanding why. I never got to grips. I was so bad at maths, they wouldn't even let me sit my O level. How do you explain this, Gary?
How many of you here believe for 1 minute that those twins are smarter than you? For 1 minute. 1 minute. For one minute. How many of you believe that they are smarter than you? They are smarter than you? How many of you believe that they are smarter than you? Okay. We're going to figure that out today, and I think we'll settle it once and for all. But let me tell you the truth. When you or I came out of our mother's birth canal, we had one brain. All of us had one brain. In that brain, they've just done some analysis of real-life imaging now, because we now have the technology to be able to look at people's brains while they're still alive. We couldn't do that about 50 years ago. Now we've worked that out. Because in California, there is a massive citrus company that makes orange juice, right? And they make smoothies, and they make orange squash. They now give you a seed to take, and they image your brain to see what part of your brain reacts and how well it lights up. So we have so much technology to be able to literally image your brain cell by cell while you are still alive. We never had that about 50 years ago. So you were right 50 years ago if you had the firm feeling that somebody had a bigger brain than you. Now what we found out is when we came out of our mother's womb, all of us individually had 1 million brain cells. All of us. neurons is built. Now, one neuron, they did a bit of experiment with it. It's Texas Instruments. Everything I'm telling you, you can verify them. And by the way, you're going to have to go and watch that video because I don't have all the time to watch it, for, to show it to you and do a quick analysis. But it's available on YouTube. You saw how I put it up, right? It's available on YouTube. That's part of what the lady that came before me was trying to tell you, that you are enabled. Do you know what that means? You are on steroids. That means you can run the Olympics and still not be disqualified because you have technology at your fingertips. For free, you can watch that video, any from any part of the world. So one brain cell was tested by Texas Instruments. One brain cell against a calculator. Which one will act faster and better? One brain cell won. Subtract, one brain cell won. Just one brain cell, one brain cell. Multiply, one brain cell won. Divide, one brain cell won. So they now brought a combined strength of four calculators and raised it again, one human cell. Guess who won? One human cell. They've repeated it now. And they just published, you can Google it. Everything I'm telling you, you can find out why I'm still talking, because you've got a powerful thing that they call a mobile phone that I call a learning device. If my grandfather had this, he didn't need to go to the library. Because the library came to your house, and you've forgotten that the library is in your hands. It's called www. There are more books here than any physical library on the planet. Do you understand why I say you are enabled? I've used that several times. You probably work out why I say every single child is a genius. Now, they raised one human cell against a NASA computer. You know NASA computer? You know, NASA sends men to the moon and brings them back. And NASA has calculated that all of us can journey to Mars. It will take us 500 days. Now, my grandparents, if you told them that, they would have thought you'd gone nuts. Do you still understand what I'm saying? This is the golden generation. They raised one human cell against the computer of NASA. Guess who won? Who computed faster and quicker? One human cell. Not all of it, not two, one. Now, the last experiment they did is that they looked at the network of all the computers that NASA has. All the computers. And raised it against one cell that you have in your brain and found out that one brain cell was still superior to NASA. So do you understand why I say every single child is a genius? We may not have been nurtured as genius. We may not have been informed we were geniuses. We may have been lied to. Because if I had my teacher, I would have asked him the question, why didn't he put me in for a GCSE in mathematics at the age of 6? Because these little rascals passed their GCSE at 6. And Samantha passed a double GCSE at 6. And at the age of 7, they went and did A-level. And they represent the county in rugby. So they are violent when it comes to football, right? Do you understand? And they do the 100 meters race and represent the county, not just the school. Do you understand what I'm trying to say? Are you sure?
Yeah.
There's no one that has sat down as a neurologist that has looked at our mental capacity and therefore estimate our intellectual ability. Most of us have been told about our intellectual ability on the back of an assessment that was done by a teacher that has no training whatsoever in what I can or cannot do.
Thank you.
If you have a four-year-old, for those of you that believe that they are smarter than you, if you have a four-year-old niece, nephew, cousin, I can walk you through how you can get your four-year-old niece or nephew or cousin or child to supersede every single thing they've done. Did you hear? I say exceed their score. Because you have the benefit of their experience, and they didn't have the benefit of anybody's experience. Because if you brought a four-year-old here now and asked a four-year-old, if I push this, do you mind? If I push this cup here, what will happen when it gets to the edge? As a four-year-old, will it drop? Will it stay hanging? Or will it fly up? What will the four-year-old tell you? It will drop. A four-year-old, he or she understands the fundamentals of gravity. That's physics. If you get a four-year-old and give him or her a hula hoop, and say, play with the hula hoop, they will play with the hula hoop. Do you know what that means? That's centrifugal forces. That's inertia. That's momentum. I can teach you 16 different physics concepts on the hula hoop. So who is stupid? Mercedes makes cars and the cars drive on the road. Do you know that?
boy makes planes and they always fly. Are you saying somehow you were made defective, that you don't achieve what you were made for? So in talking about education, I've always seen education as trying to bring out the best of you. Work on you and bring out what are you so good at that nobody can beat you in. Who's, how many of you support Arsenal? Let me be tribal here. Okay. All of you that support Arsenal would have probably heard about this. And the rest of you, how many support Bolton? How many of you hate football?
You hate football.
I'm sure of those of you that keep your hand up, if you hate football, I'm going to ask you a question. Have you heard about Fabrice Muamba?
Yes. The guy who played.
There you go.
Thank you. Okay. Fabrice Muamba was brought to me at the age of 12. And the mother said, look at that boy. He's very, very bad. He's very bad. He doesn't work. He plays all the time in school. All he knows is football. And they introduced him to me. I said, okay, that's fine. You like football? Yes. Who's your favorite player? I said, Patrick Vieira. Great. You know what? I just got homework for him. Next week, can you write me 15 things that most people don't know about Patrick Vieira? That's right. I didn't tell him to read Shakespeare. The school told him to read Shakespeare. I told him to read about Patrick Vieira. Do you know what he wrote? 30 pages on Patrick Vieira. So can he read or can he write? And I asked him, have you been man of the match anytime? So yes, several times. How many times have you been man of the match? Look at what I'm doing. If I say how many times, you know what I'm doing? I'm asking you, please calculate. And then he told me. Have you scored any goals before? Yes. How did you score? He told me. On what position did you score? He told me. I said, great. Hey, you're good at match. I said, no, I'm not good at match. No. Because they put him in the bottom set in the school to do a foundation paper. Because he's been told that his brain cannot do maths. And he came trying to educate me about his own ability, when I really should be educating him about his own ability. And then I gave him a maths paper to do. After about almost half an hour of discussion, wanting to know his interest, where he's going, and the mom very nervous, getting annoyed. I brought him here for maths, and you spending all the time talking about football. And even gave him an assignment to do more football. Whose side are you on? I went to the photocopier, I gave him the foundation paper. He said, let me know which topics you're good at. Do the foundation paper. I said, yes. And then next, I then gave him the higher paper to do. He said, but I thought you were my friend. I thought you know Arsene Wenger. You were just talking now. No. I can't do this. Go and get more foundation. I went straight back to the photocopier. I photocopied front page, foundation, and every other page, higher. I gave it to him. He went through the same paper that he rejected a minute ago. And when he was marked, he had 50% of the questions right. Then I said, okay. Went back, did another copy of another year, higher paper, but proper foundation, he did it. Then I came back down with the higher paper. He said, no, where are the other foundation papers? Do you understand what we're talking about? Mental conditioning? But we've been lied to. Every single person in this room, I can bet on your life that you can speak 15 different languages. You know why? Their sister, their elder sister, Anne-Marie, spoke 10 languages before leaving primary school, and yet had 2 GCSEs before leaving primary school. And played netball, captain netball, while primary school. Play the musical instrument for our primary school. So who's put the limit on our abilities? So do you understand why I came here to wake you up? Because there's a giant in you that you put to bed when you were 7 or 8, based on what you heard. Now I need to revive the giant in you. That's the reason why my PowerPoint slide tells you, CNN says, describes me as a genius producing machine. Right? They said I'm a genius producing machine. I'm not a genius producing machine. You're a genius, I just try and uncover the genius in you. so that you can operate or flow in your area of interest. I've not seen one child in my life that can't pass GCSE maths at 7. No. I have a young lady, she lives on the 7th floor, because somebody took a bet against me. She was on the 7th floor in Peckham. You know Peckham?
Yes.
Is that known for academic achievement? A 5-year-old. A 5-year-old. Check it out, write this down. D is the first name, D-E-E, and the surname is A-L-L-I, D. Ali. The mother works in a nursery, the father works in Asda. None of them are mathematicians. She wrote the Cambridge, A-L-L-I, the last name, you can Google it. She wrote the Cambridge Mathematics, GCSE, and she got a C at the age of 5, after only 7 weeks work. So who's stupid? 7 weeks, not 9 months. 7 weeks. And the male was trying to interview her. Oh, yes, if that's the case, what book did you read? What book did you read? What textbook did you read? And she said, no, I didn't read the textbook. Say, oh, we told you, isn't that Jean? No, she didn't read the textbook so that the recommended textbook will not distract her or miseducate her. The 2 things we do, the children of that age. Do you understand what I'm trying to tell you? So every single person here, the minimum you can do is walk out with the first class in your next exam. Promise me that? You get the highest possible marks in your exam. So I want 15 of you to all score 98. Do you promise me that?
Yes.
I'll tell you, it's a very simple formula. Simple formula. Half of you don't know how best you learn. Some of us are auditory. Who knows David Blunkett? David Blunkett?
Yes.
Yeah. When they tell me to debate with David Blunkett on BBC, I feel like falling off sick. Do you know who he is?
Yes.
He's the ultimate debater. Yeah, the man doesn't see. If he had read his textbook, he would fail. Is that true? And we all agree that. If he watched my PowerPoint slides, he would what? He will fail. He's recognized that the best way he learns, because he's visually handicapped, is auditory. So he gets his material 100% what? Auditory or braille. Because of that, I'm afraid of him. Are you with me here? So tell me, are you a visual learner? Are you an auditory learner? Are you kinesthetic? Or are you a blended learner? If you tell me what learner you are, I'll compress your entire semester's work. I'll condense it, and I'll make sure I put all of them here. So you hear it on the bus, you hear it on the train, you hear it everywhere you go to. If you're visual, I'll put it here as MP3 files. Do you understand that? So you watch it. You suspend your addiction to recommended textbooks. Because that's what most of you do. You carry your books, you think they're carrying babies, right? You carry their folders. And I just look at them and I shake my big hand. I said, wow, I wish somebody can tell this young man or this lady that don't waste your time. Because I know that each time you read a recommended textbook, you have only done what? Wasted your time. I've worked it out mathematically. Each time you read any book, you've only found 20% of your time useful. The rest 80 were wasted. That's the reason why most of you that go through read thick medical books, you find out that they write a textbook and then they write a revision book. Now, why didn't they tell you about a revision book at the beginning of the term? Why is it that you found out only 2 weeks of the exam that you could have done everything in 20 pages and you were doing 100 pages? Did you understand what I'm trying to say? So can you see why you are getting you to promise me that you top the class? Because the techniques you're going to use will be different from the ones your friends that are not here today are using. They're going to use the old technique. And I'm going to trust you use only the mobile phone. And they think that you're listening to Beyonce. When really you're listening to real lecture. Or they think it's Michael Jackson or whoever you're listening to. You're not listening to that person, you're listening to yourself. And I don't have time, I would have taken you through the hoops. We listen, you record your voice, and then you attempt the paper. And then you record your voice, and then you listen. When you've done that multiple layers, it's called multiple layers. I'm out, right? Okay, I'm out of time.
So
Thank you.
Awesome.
Okay, let me bring this home to you. When is the 5 minutes extension, right?
Yes. 7 minutes.
I'm not even going to slide 2 years. I'm just warming up. Quite seriously, we do this on weekends, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, and by the time you're out, you're liberated. One thing that I must get you to understand, the industry is interested if you get a first class. She will tell you, because she's been investment banking, right?
I got a first class.
The banks will tell you that they'll prefer you if you have a first class. So if you show any promise at any age, the banks will pursue you. I never knew. I thought it was illegal to allow anybody under 18 to work until Deutsche Bank wrote me a letter. So the 13-year-old misspelled exactly the way it was written in the mail. And then the next day I got a letter from Merrill Lynch. And then I got a letter from Goldman Sachs. That's how I knew that a 13-year-old is not child labor. It is good in computing. It will happen to you. I guarantee you employment anytime you show excellence. That's what I'm saying. And I guarantee you employment anytime you show what? Genius. So they're just out there waiting for you to express genius. I guarantee you employment, because I went for an event in Oxford and they turned down Ken Livingstone at the door. He was the mayor. And they allowed me in. I was very uncomfortable. Hang on. This is a black man, African accent, right? And he is the mayor. Why are you not letting him in? And they said, oh, look, they are special guests. So what is special about me? I said, are you a Mafidon? Say yes. He said, everything is special about me. Do you understand what I'm trying to say? I can put my life on the line. Because it's not only happened to me, I've finished Fabrice's story. Do you know what happened to Fabrice? He eventually wrote the GCSE after I fooled him and then showed him 2 papers, he almost broke down in tears. Eventually wrote his GCSE 1 year early, and he's the youngest person ever to have written GCSE in the school. It's a technical school. It's E17. Can you find that out? On premiership, he then ended up having 10 GCSEs and 3 A-levels while he was playing football. Do you understand what I'm trying to say? You can be efficient. If you're in enterprise and 3 of us are bidding for a contract with her, do you know what happens? They look at her profile and look at my profile. I never knew that. And they prefer the person that has shown excellence. So whether you want to be in enterprise, self-employed, or you want to be employed, you need to show visible genius that's in you. So for your own sake, for your profile's sake, you heard what she said. She said it for the first class. Do you know what that means? There is no competition against her. So the bank will not see her color. The bank will not see her gender. Because the bank will not be interested in who you are. They are interested in what you bring to the table. Just like premiership football. They'll buy you if you're scoring against them. Even if you don't have a place for you, they'll still buy you and put you on the bench so that you don't score against them. That's why they wanted me to sign on behalf of my daughter at 13 that she will work for Deutsche Bank for the rest of her life. And Goldman Sachs wanted me to sign that she will have an accelerated career so that when she is 22, she'll become the vice president. I said, what did you see in her that's making you, she's any different from all her 30 friends in her class? There were 30 students in the class. And ladies and gentlemen, she was not even the brightest. I can give you her school records. She didn't top the class in all the subjects all the time. There were people that did better than her. But she knew and she realized what she could do. And she was given a slightly different nurturing. And then she expressed her genius and everybody knew. The boy that did better than her still does better than her. And I still believe he's better than her. But I still talk high about it, just in case she gets solo headed, right? His name is Tolu. Tolu does not see any reason to go to university today. So why do you think I think I'm a failure? I should have persuaded that boy, bought him his favorite Arsenal t-shirt, bought him his boots, and made him write the exam with her at the same time. I just told the parents that's a nice idea. And the parents said that's a bummy idea. Why expose children at that age? Let them be children. I said, but she's more child. If there's any facilities or parameters for assessing children, she's more of a child than your son. I said, yes. No, I don't want him to write the exam. If I bribe the boy and told him I'll give him PlayStation, which means nothing in the grand scheme of things, or a new mobile phone, he would have cornered his mom, gone to write the exam,
that's right,
and the result would have been what they call ripple effects. Mm. So she would have had a challenger, and that would have pushed her on. So instead of Oxford writing her a letter and saying, come and study at 13, Oxford may probably would have lowered it. Do you understand what I'm saying? Do you understand? When there is excellence expressed in one area, the whole area gets lifted up. Mm. When there is pollution of mediocrity as we have now, you know what happens? It has a depressing effect. So that's the reason why I believe every single child is a genius. And if every single child is a genius, and the American Constitution says that we hold these truths to be self-evident, ladies and gentlemen, this is what the American Constitution says, that all men were created equal.
That's right.
Do you understand that? As at that time, no woman could vote. Did you understand? As at that time, no black could vote. As at that time, not one single girl could study at Oxford or Cambridge. It was a very powerful idea, but our generation is now living it. The fact that Hillary can even say, I want to run for presidency, is a massive victory. The fact that we have Oprah Winfrey is a massive victory. So gender is no longer an issue. Color is a waste of time. I don't know what color I am. I don't. Because each time I write a letter, it doesn't show that it's written by a black man, a white man, a green man, a yellow man, or a dented man. So I don't know what color I am. When I drive the car, it doesn't say black or white. Do I? Does it? When you get an injection from a doctor in the hospital, does it say black or white or green? So I don't know what color it is. You need to remind me. When somebody says, no, don't you know I'm black? I say, I didn't know. Because I'm colorblind. If you are green, it still doesn't make any difference to me. But it's just your imagination. It's what somebody told you you are. I'll play Amari's video for 1 minute and then
when
I'll
wait. When Anna-Maria Macedon was 11 years old, she passed A-levels in computing and maths. Then when she was 13, she passed an A-level in further maths. And now she's off to Oxford University. It's gifted pupils like Anne-Marie that the government now wants schools to put on a list and register with the National Academy for Gifted and Talented Youth.
The register will enable students to play a part in the activities of the National Academy for Gifted and Talented Youth, which organises summer school.
2 years later, I got to meet Lord Adoni. That's Lord Adoni. He was Education Secretary. He finished from Keble College in Oxford. And I was asking him a question. He said 25% of us are gifted. I said, that's fine. Do you have children? Yes. Which of your children are talentless or without gift? And each time politicians tell me we have 50% to go to university and 50% not to go, I ask, okay, Tony Blair, you have how many children? Four. The first half will not go to university. The other half will go, so no. So whose children are you saying are without talent? And where are the parameters? I've not been able to convince myself that my neighbor's children are talentless, but mine have all the talent. I only have five children. There are about 16 different professionals. I need a doctor, I need a lawyer, I need a dentist. Will my children, all five children, become 16 different professionals? So why would you want to be selfish to make it a family secret that how my children pass the exam has to be hidden away from you so that your son can fail and I look very important? That's a false sense of importance. If anything, that is ignorance. Thank you. I owe you some money, I'll give you something that's signed and you take it. You know why? She's about the only person that heard her. She heard technology, she used technology. Each time I come into a hall, I normally tell, they all say, switch off your phone now. Switch it off. And when I get hold of the mic, I say, would you mind switching it back on? Tweet about the profound things you've heard today, and this is my hashtag, @ChrisImafido. I tell you, record everything I say. And please, when you go for your next class, do you know what you need to do? Press record. If the lecturer doesn't find it too comfortable, sit at the back. If you still don't find it, cover it with a sheet. You know why? Because you cannot write as fast as he or she talks. You just, that's why it's called voice notes. It's an app that's there for you. I have a 17-year-old that's just become a multi-millionaire by writing an app. All the app does is summarize news item and gives it to you. A 17-year-old. So what is your excuse? Are you an excusiologist? Looking for reasons not to fail. To fail. Failure is an alien concept. So I hope I've provoked you enough. And I'll put up my website for you to see. And I'll be available here until the cows go. And I do apologize. Westminster upset my program for the day. Thank you.
Okay, our next guest is a private banker at Barclays Wealth and Investment Manager, Management. The topic she is talking about today is an insight on wealth and investment management and how to forge a career in the industry. So could I please invite Mika Townsend to the stage, please.
Hi everyone. Not quite sure how to follow that app, I'm not going to lie, so I'm not even going to try. First of all, just a little correction, my name is pronounced Misha Townsend, but everything else is accurate, so that's fine. So I am probably the least seasoned of the professionals here today, as I was in your shoes 3 or so years ago, so I've just finished the graduate scheme, literally finished in April, so just over 2.5 year scheme. Graduated in June, started in July, and like Heather said earlier, I did an internship and I had my job offer in November 2009 to start in July 2010. So they really do like to get in there early. So I'll start what I do now and then I'll work backwards to how I got there. But so the scheme I'm on is rotational. So it also helps if you're not quite sure what you want to do. You know you like this area of finance, or you have a vague idea, but you're not sure what it's like on a day-to-day basis. One of the advantages of this is that you do move around different areas. So my first year was spent working with the private bankers. So basically, people who go out, find rich people, and then make them richer. And everyone's happy about that situation. So went out to meetings with them, speak to people, find out their needs, find out how you can help them, and then find out the best plan to get them to realize their goals. I then spent 6 months on our product side, so our research, products and investment side, on the private equity, hedge funds and real estate team. So that was going out, meeting private equity managers, hedge fund managers that we thought were good enough for our clients to invest in. So that was very interesting, as you get some really crazy niche investments. Like one was about a guy who has made millions from getting disused airplane parts, reconfiguring them somehow, and then selling them on to someone else. I didn't know how it worked, but he spoke so passionately, and it was very interesting. In the end, we didn't bring on that idea, but it was very useful to see all the different ways that you can make money, and that if you put your mind to it, you can make money out of anything, as long as you know what your goals are and have a plan to get there. So that was my, I spent 6 months there. Then I did a 6 month international rotation. So I was based out in South Africa for 6 months on a research team there as well. So Barclays in South Africa is Absa, so I was at Absa Wealth. And that was just a great experience to see how markets are run from a completely different country. Clients' needs are different, so you have to adapt to that. Different products are offered, different styles, talking to people, working with people. And those are all skills that you need on a day-to-day basis, so that really helped my development. Then my rotations were done, so you go back to the team you started on, and you kind of start the transition between graduate to banker. You do a lot of soft skills training, a lot of role plays. And there's also, you do work towards a CFA qualification throughout the graduate scheme. And I'll be doing that exam in 3 weeks' time, so hopefully I can soak up some of your wisdom on how to use all my brain cells to their full potential. But yeah, so that's what I'm doing now. Previous to Barclays, like I said, I did kind of go straight from university, but I studied economics and management. Though what I studied is irrelevant because there aren't topics that Barclays ask for. You have a degree. I think they do ask for a 2-1. But if you have a degree in anything, you can apply because everything they want you to know, they will teach you when you turn up on day one. So it doesn't matter if you spent 3 years acting, you can still do this job because Barclays will teach you from scratch. And they actually probably do prefer it if you know less about what you're going to do. As Heather said, you need to do it the Barclays way. So if you don't know another way, it probably helps. Saying that, I did intern at a competitor. So the year before, so between my second and third years of university, I spent 10 weeks working at HSBC in their global banking client management division, which was kind of a hybrid between private banking and corporate banking. So I worked on the real estate team, and all the clients were basically the big house builders, the companies that own all the buildings in the city and lease those out. Those people who came to us, told them, they want to issue a bond tomorrow or they need to raise £500 million worth, equity or debt, what's the best way to do it? And then we'd go out and help them do that plan. I would say that doing an internship did help, as it is true. Banks do take a lot of people from their interns, because the internship process and the graduate application process are exactly the same. So everything that you have to do to get on the graduate scheme, an intern would have to do an internship there. So once you've got on the internship scheme, they already know that you meet all the criteria they were looking for. And on top of that, they've had 8-10 weeks of seeing you on a day-to-day basis, knowing how you work, knowing you can sit there and not, piss everyone off all day, which is something that you need to be able to do, considering you will see these people more than you see a lot of other people, your girlfriends, wives, boyfriends, kids. You will see the people you work with a lot of the time. So if people don't get on with you, they're not going to want to hire you. And that really became clear to me in the Barclays Wealth application process. Because it's an assessment center, so they're all pretty standard across the bank. So there's usually online tests, and then aptitude tests, verbal reasoning, numerical, and then some do telephone interviews for first stage, or it could be a face-to-face interview. And then there's usually a full day of individual tasks, group tasks, interviews, and it's quite a long day. But at the end of it, so what I found out was I thought that was the final stage and there was no stage after that. I got a call probably a week or so later after my assessment center, and I was told that I needed to come back for another interview. And the HR woman told me that I didn't sound happy when she told me this, and I just said that I was very confused because I thought the assessment center was the end, then either you get it or you don't, so I just wasn't sure what this interview was about. And she said the reason for it is that on the day you did very well, you passed all of the parts that you need to pass, and we think you could be an asset to Barclays. However, how it works is that someone on the day has to choose you for their specific team. So you could get 100% on all the tests and do fine in your interview, but if the people you spoke to on that day did not say, right, I want her or I want him to turn up in 6 months' time, you can't get the job. So what she said is that one of the directors there had been interested in me, but hadn't actually spoken to me just because of how the process worked. So he wanted to meet me to have me on his team, potentially. So that's what happened. I met him, and it wasn't even an interview, it was actually a chat. He said, I've seen your CV, you were at the assessment center, so there's no point telling me all that stuff. I think one of the questions he asked me was, if you had to choose all your friends, which three would you invite to a dinner? You can only have three. Everyone else you like or care about can't come, so make sure you choose the right three. And then he was like, and what thing would each of them say about you, and why have you brought them there? And I really was not prepared for that question, so I was scrambling, but it was just, he wanted to see how you think. He wanted to have a chat, because as I said, he was going to have to work with me on a day-to-day basis. So it's very well if I was, you know, the seven-year-old genius, or if I could do every test with my eyes closed, but if he can get to like me, and also with the wealth, because it is a people business, you're speaking to people. When you go out, you're selling yourself as well. So if he didn't believe that I could do it to him, why would I, why should, you know, anyone on the street when I'm trying to go out and get clients, why should they believe me if I can't even sell it to him? So it was a very useful experience, and it probably is also some things that is useful to think about. Just, you know, what are your best qualities? What would your friends say about you? And what do you bring to the table? Because everyone brings something. Just sometimes we don't spend that time working out what it is. So yeah, I'm not really sure what to talk about further. So I've had 2.5 years in the industry. So it's small compared to, you know, 41 years at Bank of America. But you know, I like I said, I can, with questions and stuff later, I can really talk about the real life experience that I've done it so recently, the applications, and also, you know, if you do some applications and you do get rejected, don't give up, because I got rejected from, I think, Deutsche Bank. I didn't even pass their test, which confused me, because I passed all the other ones and it seemed the same. But you know, sometimes maybe I did that one when it was 1 a.m. and I wasn't really paying attention, or maybe I'd just done so many I got complacent and thought I could do them in my sleep. But you know, you really do have to take every application as a fresh application. Give it your 100%. Just because you've done 10 tests before doesn't mean that you've mastered the art. And these are different questions, different time pressures, so you need to be as prepared as you can. So, and yeah, the internships aren't the be-all and end-all. If you don't get one, there are ways in. I recently met some people, a couple of guys who, so they work in Barclays in a role we call a PBE, which is basically an assistant to the bankers. They do a lot of the admin stuff, the day-to-day banking for the clients. And this guy had applied to all the banks, all the, you know, accountancy firms, consultancy firms, everyone under the sun, and he got rejected from all of them. But he said, that's not going to stop me. I know this is what I want to do. I'm obviously just not, you know, selling my strengths in the right way, or I'm going wrong somewhere. But what he did was he applied for this PBE role. So he's not doing exactly what he wanted to do now, but it has been shown we do have a lot of PBEs who are now bankers. And it's a useful way of getting in as well, because you actually interact with the clients a lot. So they get to know you. You often go to meetings as well. So just because you haven't come through the graduate scheme route, or you're not starting off as a banker, you're still gaining loads of skills and making loads of opportunities. Like if someone on that team leaves and the rest of the team know you can deal with those clients already, you might actually be given those clients. You can just pass the relevant exam and move from there. So once your foot is in the door, people really do start to see your skills. And once you're in the door, it doesn't matter what you studied at university, what you got, even though first classes are amazing and this still means you still do have to go out there and get them. But once you're in there, it's about what you do on a day-to-day basis. You won't be judged on what you've done before. It's what your potential and what you're doing now that people will judge you on. So yeah, that's me.
For you. Our next guest is an ex-Barclays banker. He worked there for 18 years. He's going to give us an insight into graduate recruitment. So could I please invite Mr. Reza Zaidi to the stage.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon, everybody. Actually, 13 years with Barclays and similar to Misha, I joined the graduate program. I studied law and economics at University of Leicester. Second year, funnily enough, I worked for HSBC on an internship voluntary for 8 weeks while the rest of my friends went holiday interrailing. So I'm not really bad about that, but it was a good experience. And because of that, my third year, I joined Barclays in the graduate program. Why did I choose Barclays? It was because of the rotational program. 21 years old, didn't really know what I wanted to do in my career. Barclays offered me the variety. And then from there, I stayed with Barclays for 12 years. I built a bit of a career in risk and compliance. I worked with Barclays in Europe, Africa, Middle East, and then worked for a couple of investment banks, and so it went on. But what I wanted to talk to you guys about today, and very briefly, because I know time is limited, is the graduate program. So for Barclays, I actually sat on the other side of the table where Misha recently was. So I was actually one of the recruiters for Barclays on the graduate program. So I just wanted to talk to you about some of the experiences, but also I do recruit graduates and interns in my current role in GE Capital, where I'm the head of compliance. And although there's a huge amount of competition, there are some great tips in terms of kind of how to go about. So I want to share some of those with yourself. I think the first thing to say is one of the key things we look for in graduates in banking is around potential. So I fully subscribe to the point that it doesn't really matter what you study. I think it's slightly different if, for example, you're looking to get into medicine and you've got a degree in accountancy. You know, it might be a little bit tough to get into that. But for example, I studied law and economics. A colleague of mine studied sports science. We both got into Barclays. So it's about potential. And so the key thing is when you do these applications, and they are quite long to do and quite, you know, as one of our kind of speakers was saying, it takes a lot of hard work to do. It's actually how do you evidence potential in your application form. A lot of onus on your extracurricular activities. So for example, I was a member of a couple of societies at university. So how do you evidence leadership skills, effort, how do you evidence teamwork, and the ability to work unsupervised on your own as well and deliver. All of these good things actually get you through the door for the interview. The next thing once you're in is actually your own personality, having the confidence, being able to adapt. So there will be a lot of difficult questions thrown at you that you won't expect. How do you actually adapt to those? And you know, one of the questions one of the answers I sometimes get is, I don't know, or can I come back to that? And that isn't seen in a negative light. What would be seen in a negative light is where it's absolutely clear that the person is actually making the answer up on their feet, or actually even worse, that they're being a bit economical with the truth. So being truthful, honest, is absolutely key. Another very important point I just wanted to touch upon is around social media, but actually taking a slightly different spin on social media. And that is, you guys have got a great tool in terms of building your own network. LinkedIn, I can't, you know, really undersell that. It's an absolutely great tool. I'm an introvert, right? So naturally, in a crowded room, I'm not the first person to go out and meet people. But about 8 or 9 years ago, I built my profile on LinkedIn, and I started building the network through my own connections, and that's kind of went on. And my last two roles that I've got, I was headhunted through LinkedIn. So you know, I'm testimony to the fact that it does work, but you've got to use it in the right way. When we recruit people in our organisation, both Barclays and in GE Capital, whether HR does it or not, I do look for people on Facebook, I do look for people on LinkedIn. And so you've got to be very careful about how social media can actually work against you as well. If a candidate, for example, has some outwardly controversial views on Facebook, you know, that impacts the reputation of the firm. I work in compliance, and one of the kind of key remits for us in compliance is around reputational risk. What was discussed earlier today, and that, you know, we are the custodians of the firm's reputation. So when I hire somebody in my team, I want to know what their integrity is, and I will go onto the social media to find out what it is. So I'm not the only person who does it. In some organisations, as part of HR's due diligence process, they do look at social media. So although it's a great tool to have, you have to be very careful about what's actually out there and how much information you actually provide through social media. The other aspect I wanted to briefly touch upon this afternoon is around your own networking as you get into the roles, into jobs in terms of like either internship. One of the key areas around GE Capital that we've recently introduced is voluntary internship. I, last year in the summer, I took on an intern for 6 weeks, and it was unpaid work. She lost 6 weeks out of her summer. I couldn't give her the most interesting work to do, to be honest with you, but what she did do in those 6 weeks is build her connections within the organisation, and now she's applied for a the graduate programme, which is paid, which is rotational, and she's got a very good chance of getting in, but she knows the key people who her name and her application is going to go through. So voluntary internships actually, in this current environment, is something which is very popular, and you have to be proactive about it. You have to reach out to the type of organisations you want to work through your own connections, and see what's available. On the hiring side, for me, I love voluntary internship because I don't have to get anybody's sanctioning, budget sanctions to bring somebody on board. I was able to bring them on board straight away. I got them a desk, I got them a laptop that they could use, and they were on straight away. So, it's a bit of a win-win situation, but it's a key kind of example of how you can use your own networks to actually get your foot through the door and build that experience. So that's all I kind of wanted to kind of touch upon very briefly, because time is limited, but I'm around till about 3:30, so if there are any other questions or anything, I'm happy to answer them.
Thank you, Reza. We are going into the question and answer session now. So the floor is open. And ask questions between now and the next 15 minutes because we've got to keep the time. Thank you. Questions?
Thank you. The name is Anthony. Are you getting? My question goes to Dr. Imafidan. First of all, I mean, it's a two-pronged question actually. How did you come about this discovery that led you to challenge, you know, the potentials of the human brain? I mean, it's not the kind of things that one, you know, usually comes across in books. And so how did you personally come about this course that you're following? And the second question is, the twins that we heard speak on YouTube, what's your relationship with them? How did you discover them and how far were you able to go with them? Thank you.
Sorry, I've just underscored what you said about LinkedIn, and what you said about LinkedIn, I get more jobs, interview calls, and contracts from LinkedIn than I get anywhere else. So if you're going to make a photocopy of your CV and distribute it to everybody, that costs you stamps, money, paper, time. You just put it up, everybody gets it. So that's very simple as that. If not, you can get a first class stamp and post it to everybody. I'm always asking questions. If you ask questions, you're triggering aspects of your brain. I didn't know that. If you accept answers, you're saying, yes, I don't need to find out anymore. Number two, I'm a researcher. As an academic, you have to do research. And when you see things being flagged up, you need to be able to find out, really, is this the limit? And that's what makes every single one of us human beings. Because we ask questions, we ask questions. We ask our grandparents questions, our parents questions only 3 or 4, until they say, keep quiet. And when they say, keep quiet, Einstein says, you have shut down the curiosity, and you might as well have killed the person. So I'm always very curious, and I'm still challenging, probing, trying to find out what is the minimum age for you to graduate from Oxford. And I'm hoping that all your children, that means the next generation, should be graduating, all of them as teenagers, not at 18. The current educational system was decided, do you know when? In 1440. It's gone past its sell-by date. Politicians will admit to you privately that they don't have the courage to come out publicly to say it. Because I don't know who's going to discover cancer, but one of you here should discover cancer.
That's the cure.
Or the cure for cancer. Or AIDS. One of you should keep it work out AIDS. If you can put a man on Mars, we can look after someone that came out of our womb. Come on. We just got to, I tell this to presidents, I tell it to, yesterday I spent half of my life with a president of a country that believed in the fact that God makes three types of people, dumb, average, and good. Because I told him that if he gets the entire population of his country educated, he'll be richer than his neighbors that have oil. and have oil wells, because this oil would never go dry. So I hope he takes it seriously. He said he's going to come back to me, but he knows it's too radical for his lecturers to absorb. So that's the first question. Don't stop until you get the final answer. And I'm pleased the way you're questioning them. Question the bankers, because they have a lot to tell you. Question them, find out why did they do this? Why did they ask about teamwork? Why is Sir Ferguson so respected and revered? Why does he think that you need five fingers to be able to hold any object? Get that down. What did you say was question? Second question again?
Yeah, what do you use in your relationship with the children, you know?
I'll charge you for that. Oh, sorry, because you didn't see the whole video. Because they went on to ask me, what does my mom eat? What does my father eat? What does my wife eat? That the children were coming out that way, because he thought it wasn't the food or the drink. They are my biological children. And your house is your experiment. PJ, you know PJ, how many do psychology? PJ started from there. You know, Downey? Yeah, it started from his children. Your home is your biggest experiment. As soon as your wife takes in, start getting present, please get the book by Professor Maxwell, Super Parenting. Professor Maxwell, he was Obama's professor's professor. He's 82 now. He's got wisdom to give all of us in this room today. If you ever hope to ever become a parent, if you hate to be a parent, wait after the class. Let's chat. You should reproduce your card.
Hi, this is Osifa, Dr. Emma Fidler. My question is that when you're in an environment where you're studying a subject that no one around you has the ability to teach you, such as hula hoops, I'm doing oil and gas management, how do you choose a learning style, or how do you know your learning style? How do you know when you're learning the right way if you don't have people studying that to ask questions? Obviously, I've got my colleagues at university, but in terms of the wider world, how do you start on the new journey?
Like football match, you see some people, they come with their transistor radio and they play the radio while they're watching. Have you seen them? Okay. How many of you ever been in a car before and your car had radio in it, so you listen to the news while you were driving, and then when you got home, you turn on the television, it was exactly the same news. Now, statistics says a quarter of you here would turn off the news because you say, I've already heard it before. Because when you were hearing it in the car, you had graphical imagination about what happened. Why is it that they locked up three ladies for 10 years? And you imagine the photographs of the ladies. You know everything if you heard it first on radio. And then when you get home, they now start showing you photographs of the ladies. You say, huh, that doesn't look what I was thinking about. You cancel it. Why? You are an auditory learner. You prefer information being channeled to you through voice. So if I were you, I'll do a search on Google and do podcasts. There are podcasts of oil and gas. I can sit down. Don't tempt me. I can sit down with you and work you through. 7 hours later, you become an expert in any single field of life. I brought up my pen when we were talking. You see this pen? It's not a pen. It has a USB. If your Wi-Fi had collapsed this afternoon, I had a backup of everything I said here on my USB. Right? It's a 2 gig. It has every single piece of information I was taught right from the first day of primary school to when I got my highest degree. This one. Evidence number one against you. That's what I did. So Google it. If you put it on Google, you see which is the most common result you see. That's what will teach you. Because you don't need a teacher in 2013. You have Google. If you Google anything, you get more outputs from it. And you can select Google. If I have 1 minute, I can do a quick demo here. You can do a Google search and do a generic search or do a specific search. So when you type anything into Google, Google will always ask you, what type of item do you want? Let's say my surname, Emafidon, right? Okay, good. What does Google give you? Google gives you one. Web, images, maps, shopping, videos, more. You can go on Google Scholar and find out how many scholarly papers I have done. No, I teach this for 12 weeks. They flew me to Beijing to teach this thing. I taught it in 10 days. Because you are the Google generation. Don't even bother to know anything. Really, if they ask you anything, you can just point it on your, and it comes out. So if you're a visual learner, look at me. You click on the video. If you like images, just click on images, you see the photographs. So there is no concept that is so difficult on the planet today that you cannot understand in 3 minutes. That's why it's so painful. In 3 minutes, you just need to go through it too. Follow me on Twitter, all right? Follow me on Twitter, follow me on Facebook. I tweet and put all of this all the time, and you can DM me. Because I don't speak Arabic. Do you understand that? Somebody sends me email in from the Saudi. I read the email. How did I read it? I gave it to Google Translate, translated to English, read it, and then replied, and translated my reply to Arabic and sent it to them. And because it took only 3 minutes, the person phones me back later and says, Assalamu alaikum.
My name is Ebenezer. Yeah. My question goes to Phil, Philip Singer, if I'm right. Yeah. You said in your presentation that regarding the marketing risk, and how do you keep your customer happy? And because you said you are taking a stand in the market, when the market goes against you, you are taking a kind of position. And with the present situation, and you have a job to keep your customer happy, let's assume I want to bank with you, I want to do business. How do you balance me with your marketing strategy?
Well, I guess in that sense, my customer would probably be the shareholder, the final analysis, because it's the shareholder we're there to protect. So, you know, we have risk management committees at a senior level, and above them, the board. So we have risk management committees, we have the shareholders, we have the board of directors. What they do, and it's generally the board of directors, they create for us something that's called a risk framework and a risk appetite. And that denotes what the board is willing to accept on behalf of the shareholders in terms of risk. What things they want us to do and what things they don't want us to do, and the way that we actually do things. So they will set those general parameters, and then within those general parameters, and those general parameters in terms of risk are to protect the shareholder so that you don't get that situation where suddenly, you know, you get an unexpected loss or you get a series of events that throw you. So the appetite is set at the top of the house, and that feeds down. And it's our responsibility really to interpret that risk appetite and make sure that we conform to it. And as I say, the analysis we do most of the time is statistical in order to do that. So yeah, does that answer the question reasonably well?
Johnny, and as Dan said, I'm the ambassador for Startup Loans. And Startup Loan is a government initiative for young entrepreneurs between 18 and 30 to start their business, and they get funded by the government. As you can see, we've already started 25,000 entrepreneurs between September 2012 and March 2013. What is Startup Loans? The government Long John, which is the business and innovation advisor to the government, approached the Prime Minister and said that he thinks the solution to economic recovery is basically to start your own business. And he originally gave 100 million to start the initiative, and then within 2 months they decided that they wanted to increase the investment, and they increased it to 117 million. And this is going to be a 3-year program for young people between 18 and 30 to start their business. They get funded by the government. James Khan is actually the chairman, which is the S Dragon's Den judge, and is the chairman of Startup Loans Company. Why Startup Loan? Normally, young people, when they want to start a business, they have to use their parents' collateral to back up the investment. You know, your parents' mortgage, and we don't have that kind of investment. So the best way to go about it is go through agencies like Prince's Trust, you know, Rockstar Mentoring, your local council, if possible, the bank or the trade, you know, housing associations to help you to start your business. So going through startup loans, you get mentors, you get delivery partners, you get global partners to help you to start your business. How does it work? So you fill in an application form and you get the startup loan advisors in Mayfair head office or even around the UK. They get back to you, they analyze your business plan, they see if it's viable and they see if it's credible enough. And also it doesn't only appeal to UK national. If you're on tier one visa, which is entrepreneurship visa, and you're aged between 18 and 30, you could also get a startup loan investment. I think I'm sure between the age of 18 and 30. So, we actually in the press, we've been with Sun, we've been with the Evening Standard, people like Mary Porter, she talks about startup loan regularly. A lot of entrepreneurs talk about startup loan because it's a good initiative and it's less stressful than going to a bank because there's less they demand from you. The credit is still, it's not as rigorous as you went to a bank, it's more relaxed, and you also get delivery partners working with you to ensure that your business is actually successful. These are some of our delivery partners. So you can see there's Prince's Trust on there, there's University of Hearts, you've got the South London business as well. So whatever your business is, so if you wanted to go to invest property investment, they will give you a delivery partner that's already established within the industry to assist you in actually staying your business and making sure that, you know, your business is successful. And you also have one-on-one relationship with them, so you don't have to go through startup loan. As soon as your loan gets approved, the delivery partners work with you on the personal level, so you have a personal relationship with them. And these are some of our global partners. So we work with eBay, we go work with PayPal, Rigus. So if you want a virtual office, so you have like someone like Mayfair as your virtual office if you don't want to use your home address. So these are some of the incentives that startup loans actually offer you. So you could take between two, it depends what you need. Some people get the loan just to get a delivery partner. So realistically, you could have between £250 or up to £10,000. And some of the success stories, there's actually a lady, she's got a cake industry, and within 3 months, our product's actually in Harrods now. She's selling in Harrods from getting a loan from startup loan. There's also a guy who took £15,000 from startup loan. From within 6 months, he just wanted to develop his idea. He's now got an investment of £500,000 to actually start his business because he just wanted a platform to get a bit of money to develop his idea and get a bigger funding. So there's a lot of incentive with startup loan, and also the interest rate is minimal compared to if you went into a bank, and you've got less liability as well to have to give up, you know, if you go startup loan. Frequently asked questions. A lot of people say, so how much interest do I have to pay? Realistically, if you went to a bank, they might charge up to, you know, 10%. They might not even give you the full amount of money that you need. With startup loan, you know, they'll obviously check if your business is viable enough, and we aim to offer you the full loan amount that you need to start your business. And the interest rate is 6%. So if you took 10,000, you only paid £600 over a period of however you need it for. And yeah. And that's my contact details. So if you got any question, you could email me. And I'm also the founder and president of the Entrepreneur Society in Uni. So you could approach me to talk about your business. I could help you with your business plan. I could help you with whatever you need me to do. And we also set up in the networking room. If you got any more questions, you could come in, you know, we speak to you. And I also have a guy over there, Zane. He's the guy in charge of approving your loan and stuff like that. So he will literally deal with you. And this is Zane and Maya and James' contact detail if you have any more questions.
Thank you very much. We'd like, at this stage, I would like to say a very big thank you for everyone who attended. I would like to show our guests some appreciation, put some gifts for them. We've got this for you.
Thank you.
You shouldn't have. Misha, that's for you. We've come to the end of the seminar.
once again, I'd like to say a very big thank you for attending. I hope you've learned a lot today. We've got a networking session in the Woolly Room, so there's a chance for you to network with our guests, and you can have some food there as well, some refreshments. And please make sure you fill the feedback form, please. The feedback form, fill them and hand it over to Christine, please. Thank you, and we'll see you at our next event. Thank you.
I'm going to go to the next one.